to continue, we, as I mentioned earlier, we're going through the Second Vatican Council's dogmatic constitution on divine revelation, Dei Verbum, the Word of God. There are 6 chapters in that document. They correspond to the 6 talks that I'm going to be giving you. The first one that was in the last hour is divine revelation itself. This one right now, I'm going to be talking about the transmission of divine revelation. Tomorrow, we're going to have 4 lectures. The first one will be Sacred Scripture, its divine inspiration and its interpretation. And the next one will be on the Old Testament, and the one following that, the New Testament. And the 6th and last lecture will be Sacred Scripture in the life of the Church. Those are the 6 chapters of Dei Verbum. And they'll be the contents, although it'll be a very brief synthesis when you only have an hour to do it. Each one of those chapters could be a university level course, actually. So when I said we're trying to do an impossible thing, I meant it. But it's a beginning. You know, it's good that you even know that this exists. Now, what I'd like you to do, those of you who are especially serious, I know you're all serious because you've taken your time, which is very valuable, to come here this evening and tomorrow, if you would like to follow up and have a greater depth of understanding in this subject matter, I would encourage you very strongly to read the document, read the text, Dei Verbum. In the documents of the Second Vatican Council, you'll find it in there, the Dogmatic Constitution on Divine Revelation. Read Dei Verbum. I used to have a professor in the seminary, and he had a very thick German accent. And he was always telling us, we read so much stuff. I mean, we read books after books, commentators and so forth and so on. And his favorite expression was, return to the text. Yeah, read the text. We're talking about Dei Verbum. Read it. I strongly encourage you to read those sections of the Catechism of the Catholic Church that have to do with it, with this particular topic. And that's mainly paragraphs 50 through 141. It's not that much. You can read it in one sitting, really. Paragraphs 50 through 141, which directly deal with divine revelation. And then there's an encyclical letter of Pope Leo XIII, which is very important if you want to learn about Catholic methodology and how to read the Bible. Pope Leo XIII's encyclical on the study of sacred scripture, 18 November 1893. You can get it from the Daughters of St. Paul. You can certainly get it from Easter's Catholic bookstore in Sacramento. They could order it for you if they don't have it on hand. And then Pope Pius XII's encyclical on the promotion of biblical studies, Divino Afflante Spiritu. That's a very short reading list. Now, most of you won't read it. I know you. Most of you won't. You need to. Let me tell you something. If you don't do it, who do you think will? You know, you're going to wait for somebody else to get educated in these things? You sit back and say, well, it's not that important. You know, you wait for the priest to do it, the catechist. You do it. And if you don't do it, don't complain to me, the bishop, or anybody else that your children haven't learned their faith or your grandchildren. Do you know whose responsibility it is primarily to hand on the faith? Parents. Parents, way more than the parish priest, the director of religious education. Oh, they help. They're there to assist you. But it is primarily the responsibility of parents to hand on what they themselves have received. All right. God reveals himself to us in the person of his only Son, the Word of God. If we were angels, and we're not, but if we were, we'd be able to see God as he is immediately. Now, the blessed in heaven can do that. Now, I'm giving you something to look forward to here. When you pass on, God willing, you're in a state of grace, everything goes well, you get on the elevator, you go up. Something magnificent is going to happen. It's called beatific vision. And what that means is there is a mysterious work of grace that takes place, an elevation of the intellect which capacitates you to see God as he is. And what that means is without the mediation of created things, in the state that we're in now, the only way we can approach God really is through the mediation, the help of created things. Now, the Word of God is God himself. But God has to transmit himself to us in a way that we can grasp. We can't see him immediately, face to face. And so he deals with us on our level. Okay? In his gracious goodness, Dei Verbum tells us, paragraph 7, in his gracious goodness, God has seen to it that what he had revealed for the salvation of all nations would abide perpetually in its full integrity and be handed on to all generations. And what that means is, all right, 2,000 years ago, plus or minus, our Father revealed himself to us in the person of his only Son, his Word, Jesus. Jesus assumed a human nature, the incarnation, and he became like one of us in everything except sin. He walked in Palestine. He talked with his disciples. What a magnificent thing it must have been to walk with Jesus. To talk with Jesus. Now, we do that in our walk of faith, but imagine if Jesus himself in person were there. Now, that was a great thing. All right, so our Father did that for us, but then we know that Jesus suffered, he died, and he rose on the third day, and he ascended into heaven. Our Father wanted to perpetually preserve this revelation of his Son throughout the ages. That's the subject matter of this hour, the transmission of divine revelation, how the Word of God is handed on through succeeding generations. Okay. Christ the Lord, in whom the full revelation of the supreme God is brought to completion, commissioned the apostles to preach to all men that gospel which is the source of all saving truth and moral teaching, and to impart to them heavenly gifts. All right. The Word becomes flesh and dwells among us. Jesus teaches. He teaches his apostles and disciples mainly by his actions, also by his words. The closest collaborators of Jesus were the apostles. Of course, his mother, first and foremost, but the apostles, the 12 apostles. Now, I'm going to tell you a very, very consoling fact. I'm going to tell you about the best friends of Jesus, and it will make you feel much better. St. Peter, always mentioned first whenever the apostles are named, St. Peter was an old fisherman. St. Peter was also a very coarse, rough man. How rough was he? Well, in the Garden of Gethsemane, he took out his sword and cut off the high priest's servant's ear. How rough is that? You know, it's one thing to shoot somebody or punch them in the nose. Another thing to take out a sword and cut off their ear. Peter was bad. What about John and James? Now, I've just given you the three apostles that were closest to Jesus. The Mount of the Transfiguration, right? Who was up on the Mount of the Transfiguration? Peter, James, and John. Who was in the Garden of Gethsemane apart with Jesus? Peter, James, and John. They were special. Well, I already told you about Peter. What about James and John? You remember when they went through the Samaritan territory and they were tired and hungry and they needed hospitality? Now, Jews and Samaritans just didn't get along. They didn't like each other. And the Samaritans said, get lost. You know, no, we're not going to give you any hospitality. You remember what James and John did? They called in an airstrike. Oh, Lord, send down lightning and destroy them. That's right. That's what they did. And Jesus called them Boanerges, sons of thunder. They had quite a mother, too. Remember her? He said, oh, Lord, arrange it that my sons, these two sons of mine, might sit at your left and your right. Now, that's a Jewish mother. All right. So the Lord gathered his apostles around him. They were the main collaborators with Christ. He taught them. And then he commissioned them to go out and teach what he had taught to them. What did Jesus teach? Himself. That's the truth. Jesus taught himself. He didn't teach something extrinsic or foreign to himself. Jesus, the Lord, taught himself. And then the apostles, sanctified by that word, who is Christ, and given a special charism, that's a unique type of a gift, given by the Holy Spirit to an individual for the sake of the building up of the body of Christ, the church. The apostles were given a special charism to go out and teach Jesus to all the nations. This commission was faithfully fulfilled by the apostles, who by their oral preaching, by example, and by observances handed on what they had received from the lips of Christ, from living with him and from what he did or what they had learned from the prompting of the Holy Spirit. And this is all in paragraph 7 of De Verbum. So the apostles learned from Jesus, and then they went out and preached. The apostles were preachers. The faith was spread primarily by preaching, and not just any preaching, inspired preaching. Preaching that was graced. Preaching that was endowed with power. Now, I have always marveled that God called me to be a preacher. A few years ago, I was talking to my superior about it. Our ministry had grown, and we were literally reaching hundreds of thousands of people, probably millions by now, through television, radio, and so forth. And I was just marveling because, you know, you don't really know me. I know me. And I was marveling to my superior, why on earth God Almighty would choose a derelict like me to be a preacher? He never even batted an eye at it. He said, oh, that's easy. I said, well, why? He said, he couldn't find anybody worse. Ain't it the truth? You think nobody on the face of the earth was better than Peter, James, John, Andrew, and all the rest of that crew? Oh, no. Part of the reason Jesus called them, probably because, indeed, they were common men, not highly educated, not well-born, not wealthy, so that when they did great things, nobody was confused about it. They knew very well that the power of God was at work. I once reminded the people, Passion Sunday, and I was preaching on that, the gospel passage where Jesus rides into the holy city, seated on the foal of a jackass, and I told the people how The holy city, Jerusalem, is a type, a biblical type of the church. How Jesus rode into the church, seated on the back of a jackass, and he continues to do so. Lest we be proud about what we do. The reason God made me a preacher is, listen, you only have to listen to me for a couple hours here or there. I've got to listen to me day in and day out. An elderly woman from this area, I might add, collared me one day, and she said, "Now, Father, you know, you better be very good." And I said, "Why is that, my dear?" She said, "Because if you're not, when you die, you will go to purgatory. And you know what happens there, don't you?" And I said, "Well, no." She said, "Well, God will put you in a small room, and you will have to listen to your own tapes over and over and over again." All right, so Jesus taught his apostles, and then the apostles, under the inspiration of a particular charism, handed on faithfully what they themselves had received from the Lord. Now, in order to keep this gospel forever whole and alive within the church, the apostles left behind them bishops as their successors, handing over to them the authority to teach in their own place. Now, this is very, very important. This part of the whole little series we're doing here is of enormous importance. Pay attention, as Sister Mildred used to say to us. Sacred tradition, all right? I'm going to give you a word here. Now, if I said to you sacred scripture or the Bible, nobody bat an eye, and they say, "Yeah, everybody knows what that is, right? Here's the Bible. Everybody knows what a Bible is. This little course is how Catholics read the Bible." If I say to you, sacred tradition, a lot of blank stares come back at me. Did you know that sacred tradition has exactly the same weight in the Catholic Church as sacred scripture? Do you even know what sacred tradition is? Most people don't. That's why we're here. Now, even if you know, I'm here to confirm you in what you know. Someone once said to me, "You know, Father, you preach to the choir. Don't you realize that? All these good people who come, you're preaching to the choir." And that's largely true. But it's the choir who goes out and forms the rest of the world. So you need to be confirmed in the faith. That's basically what the apostles did and what the bishops do, confirm the brethren. All right, Jesus preached orally. He preached mainly by his example. They saw him. They saw how he acted. They saw his power. He also taught them with words. They received this. It stuck. And then they passed it on faithfully. This is an oral transmission. Remember here, we're talking about the transmission of divine revelation. So this revelation of our Father in the person of his Son, his only word, is transmitted first and foremost orally. Jesus taught orally. His apostles preached. That's an oral transmission of the faith. Some of what was preached was written down. We have two things here. Sacred scripture, the oral proclamation of the word, the apostolic kerygma, it's called. That word, kerygma, or kerygmatic, it comes from a Greek word. It has to do with an action of the Holy Spirit, a graced action. That apostolic kerygma, the preaching of the word of God, the preaching of Jesus. And there is a power that attaches to it. Through no merit whatsoever of my own. And I mean that from the bottom of my heart. I have that gift. Now, I didn't give it to myself, and I didn't discern it from myself. My superiors discerned it. Apostolic preaching. It's a specific kind of preaching. It doesn't have to do with being smart or clever. It doesn't have to do with being eloquent. It has to do with the power of God at work. What happens? Well, nothing to do with me. You know, people say, oh, we're going to go hear Father Crappie. Poor you. You know, it's the Holy Spirit who works. You know, if a great musician were to pick up a broken violin and play a beautiful symphony, the violin would be quite stupid to exalt itself, if it even could do such a thing. It's the master who's behind it all. Apostolic preaching is the primary and first way that divine revelation was transmitted. Jesus preached. The apostles preached. Some of what was preached was written down. That's the New Testament. We already had the Old Testament. Jesus entered time and space through his actions and his words. He proclaimed the truth himself, Heavenly Father. Some of what the apostles heard and saw and experienced, some of that was written down by apostolic men, the evangelists and others. We have the four Gospels, we have the letters of St. Paul, St. Peter, St. John, and so forth, the New Testament. Okay. Some of that oral proclamation, I say some of that oral proclamation, was written down. How much of it wasn't written down? Read the last paragraph of the Gospel of John to get some intimation of how much wasn't written down. John said, I doubt that the world itself could contain all the books that would be necessary to record everything Jesus said and did. Some of the oral proclamation was written down. So, divine revelation, the eternal word, the word of God, Jesus. That is transmitted to us in an oral way and in a written way. That one word of God is transmitted orally, sacred tradition, and in a written form, sacred scripture. Now, whenever you have a word, whether written or spoken, we know from experience you need to have an authentic and authoritative interpreter of that word, whether written or spoken. If not, what's going to happen is you are going to have as many interpretations of that word as you are people interpreting. I mean, I know this from my own experience. I can go out and preach to 1,000 people. One message comes out of my mouth, but you'd be amazed at how many different things are heard. You know what I mean? I mean, I have had people practically assault me, saying, you said this and this and that. I don't know what you were listening to, but you weren't listening to me. See, people receive things as they're disposed to receive things. Look at it this way. I've used this analogy many times. Some of you have heard it before. It's like, imagine a filter. You know, we have filters in our car, an air filter, you know, fuel filter, and so on. Everything we receive passes through a kind of filter. Now, that filter is the sum total of our education, our cultural biases, our upbringing, our experience. The problem is very few people check their filter. And the message, the word, gets tainted and distorted, and it comes through different ways to different people. So wherever you have a word, whether that word is written or orally transmitted, you've got to have an authentic and authoritative interpreter of that word. Now, God in his great wisdom, he knows human nature. God is the author and architect of human nature. He knows how it works. And so he knows what we need. And sure enough, he gave us exactly what we need. He gave us the apostles, and then the apostles appointed bishops to succeed them. Okay, apostolic succession. You've heard that term, perhaps. Apostolic succession. The bishops in union with the Bishop of Rome. Now, what is that called? That's called the magisterium of the church, the teaching office. That word magisterium means teaching office, the teaching office of the church. So, the apostolic preaching, which is expressed in a special way in the inspired books, was to be preserved by an unending succession of preachers until the end of time. Therefore, the apostles, handing on what they themselves had received, warned the faithful. The apostles warned the faithful to hold fast to the traditions which they have learned either by word of mouth or by letter. Now, that is a quote from St. Paul's second letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 2, verse 15. Hold fast to what you've received, either by word of mouth, preaching, or by letter, in writing, scripture. All right? So God transmits himself to us in the person of his word, and that word comes to us in a preached form, orally, and in a written form, the Bible. Now, the plot thickens. How Catholics read the Bible. Now, I respect anybody and everybody's religion. I really do. Whether you're a Christian of whatever denomination, Buddhists, Hindus, Jews, I respect everyone's religion, and I respect their right to practice their faith the way they feel moved to. I'm not a syncretist, however. That's a particular heresy which imagines that all religions are the same. They're not. You are in the right place. All right, but please don't, you know, I guess you'd call it occupational hazards of doing what I do, is that people misunderstand you, people misquote you, people say all kinds of, oh, Father Crappie said this, and he said that, and he said the other thing. Well, I might have said this, or that, or the other thing, but some of it I probably never said. And one thing I've never said is anything to knock anybody's faith. I totally respect all human beings and what every person believes. I respect their right, anybody's right, to practice their own religion. However, if you'd like to know what we Catholics do, that's what we're here for. Sacred tradition. The oral transmission of revelation given to us by the preaching of Christ, received by the apostles, handed on faithfully, the bishops, their successors, handed it on under the charism and inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the oral transmission of the Word of God, the Bible, the written transmission of the Word of God, the magisterium, the authentic and authoritative interpreter of the one only Word of God, whether written or orally transmitted. And so, we've got three essential things to deal with in divine revelation. Without these three things in place, you can't read the Bible as Catholics read the Bible. Now, I know I'm preaching primarily to Catholics here, and that's who I preach to. Anyone else is welcome to listen. But I'm preaching to Catholics. I teach Catholics. I am not, you know, the older I get, the less inclined I am to argue with anybody. I don't argue with anybody. It's my way or the highway. I don't debate. You know, every now and then someone says, would you go on television? But I don't debate. There's a place for debate, by the way. It's a good thing. You know, apologetics? Absolutely. It's a good thing. Some people are called that. I'm not called to that. Do you know, the apostles now and then, they debated now and then, but they preached from a position of authority. Why do you receive it? Because it sounds good? Because of worldly wise argumentation? No way. You receive it because God has revealed it. Now, there's one thing I have always done, and one thing I'm doing now, and one thing I'll do to the day I die, and that's hand it on faithfully as we have received it. Not just interjecting my mere personal opinions, not giving you something watered down, diminished, or distorted, giving you what we have received, and we received it from Christ, who gave it to the apostles, who handed it on to their successor, the bishop. That is what we're dealing with, the Word of God, this method of how Catholics read the Bible is of enormous importance. Now, I've traveled all over the United States. At the end of this year, I will have preached in 49 of the 50 states. By next year, it'll probably be 50 of 50. I've preached in several foreign countries. I have seen a few things in that period of time. And one of the most distressing things I've seen is that Catholics are grossly ignorant of their faith, period. And you know what happens when Catholics are ignorant of their faith? People leave the faith. That's what happens. When I was down in Central America a few years ago preaching, the bishops had a synod, and I happened to be there, and they invited me for some of the session, and they were lamenting bitterly that they had lost 5 million out of their churches in the previous 3 years alone. 5 million out of a few small countries. Everybody was Catholic in Mexico, Central and South America for years. Everybody. For every one Catholic church being built in Central America, 1,500 Assemblies of God were being built. Why? Catholics were leaving in droves. Why? In the first place, because they didn't know what they had. And so, you know, easy to leave when you don't know what you have. But if you know what you have, where are you going? They got better fellowship over there. You going to trade in better fellowship for Jesus in the Eucharist, for the Blessed Mother, for a sure knowledge of the faith that comes to us through that apostolic succession, the transmission of divine revelation? That's silly. But I understand how it can happen. We have done a poor job in many cases of teaching the faith. We priests, bishops, often we've done a poor job. That's why the Holy Father, for many reasons, he's been repenting. He's been leading the church in repentance because we haven't been that great in doing this or that or the other. And he's very humble. Man, he'll be canonized. He'll be a canonized saint when the smoke clears. I'll guarantee you that. And not only that, he will probably be, I think, the third pope in history to receive the title the Great. He'll be John Paul the Great. Now, he ordained me a priest. Not that that has anything to do. I like him, you know. But if I were pope, I probably wouldn't do a lot of things the way he does. Happily, I'll never be pope. I can barely be a priest. The magisterium of the church. Do you know where the Bible came from? You know, this is a very fundamental question. Most people don't think, and that's why we have all the ridiculous propositions that are floating around out there in outer space. This Bible didn't fall out of the heavens. Who decided what goes in this Bible? The magisterium of the church, that's who decided. The canon of Scripture was determined by the church. And remember, there was only one church for the first many centuries of history. Okay? Now, God is one. I started to tell you this before. One God, three divine persons. Fundamental theology, you all know that. God, the one God who is three divine persons, reveals himself to us. Sacred tradition, sacred scripture, magisterial teaching, no one of which can subsist without the other two. Now, I have just given you a very important, essential, fundamental truth. Divine revelation, the revelation of the one God to us in his only word, that revelation comes to us in three interconnected, compenetrated ways: sacred tradition, sacred scripture, magisterial teaching, no one of which can subsist without the other two. That means no one of which can be without the other two. No tradition and magisterium, no Bible. So when we're talking about how Catholics read the Bible, Catholics better know there's such a thing as tradition and magisterial teaching. If your concept of God is merely Holy Spirit, is your concept of God correct? Nope. No, God, we know it's one God, but three divine persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. If your concept of divine revelation is merely the Bible, sola scriptura, then your concept of revelation is erroneous. The one God revealed himself to us in the person of his word, his only word, and that word, that one only word, is transmitted to us in a Trinitarian way. How else would God do it? Tradition, scripture, magisterial teaching, no one of which can subsist without the other two. Now, I'm going to give you a very easy theology lesson here. God, one God. All right, three divine persons. Wherever one person of the Trinity is, there the other two persons must be. In virtue of what we call the mystery of unity or circumincession, the divine perichoresis. I'm giving you a bunch of theology words here. You don't have to remember. But let me say this again. The concept is important, and you can get it, and it's fundamental. And if you interiorize this, you will know more than an awful lot of theologians today. One God, three divine persons. Wherever one person of the Trinity is, there the other two persons must be. In virtue of the inviolable mystery of unity. All right. Wherever scripture is, there tradition and magisterial teaching must be. Wherever magisterial teaching is, there scripture and tradition must be. Wherever tradition is, there scripture and magisterial teaching must be. Do you understand that? Can you grasp or begin to grasp the enormous significance and the consequences of this? It's a revelation that is absolutely earth-shaking once you get it. You can understand so many things once you get this principle. So many people seek to read the Bible in a vacuum. It wasn't written in a vacuum. This isn't even the Bible unless tradition and magisterial teaching are taken into account. What it is something else. It's something else, but it's not the authentic Word of God. There are some principles, some very, very important principles in reading the Bible. You've got to follow these principles. They're essential. Now, as I said before, the full canon of Scripture was determined by the Church, by the magisterium of the Church. Now, the magisterium, once again, that's the Pope. He's the successor of St. Peter, the head of the apostolic band, and the bishops in union with him. That's the magisterium of the Church, the Holy Father and the bishops united to him. I might add, in case some confusion arises in this area, I might add that that magisterium, the authentic magisterium of the Church, is the Holy Father, the Pope, and the bishops in union with him teaching the same thing in its essence, taught by Jesus Christ, the apostles, and their successors throughout the ages, everywhere and always. That's a test. If you understand that principle, you can defuse a lot of silly arguments. All right? For instance, can any essentially new teaching come out of the atmosphere? No, no way. No, our faith has been received. It's a pearl of great price. It has been received. Well, how did we receive it? Well, God gave it to us. in the person of his Son. That revelation was transmitted to us in a Trinitarian way. Sacred tradition, sacred scripture, magisterial teaching, no one of which can subsist without the other two. Words are very, very important. The English translation of that says, no one of which can stand without the other two. Well, that's okay, but when I read it in Spanish, in French, in Latin, the word that jumped out at you was subsist. That's a philosophy word, okay? Subsistence, subsist. That's a word from metaphysics. And basically what it means, it can't exist. In other words, no one of which, the Bible can't exist without sacred tradition and magisterial teaching. This is a living word. The Word of God is a living word. It is not a mute letter. It is not a dead letter. It is living. It is Trinitarian. What are we dealing with? We're dealing with God. What has been revealed? This is so simple, it's ridiculous, but it goes over the heads of the learned and the clever. And you really got to be a little one to get this. Divine revelation. What's been revealed to us? God has been revealed to us. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit has been revealed to us. And the way he revealed himself to us was in the person of his Son, and that revelation is transmitted in the form of tradition, scripture, magisterial teaching. And you've got to know up one side and down the other what those things mean and how they are interrelated, interdependent. And I like the word, people used to make fun of me. There are people all over the country who've listened to my stuff and they memorize it. I had a kid 8 years old come up and give one of my sermons to me one day. With all the correct inflections of voice, he sounded just like me, poor thing. There's a compenetration among tradition, scripture, and magisterial teaching. Sacred scripture is the word of God inasmuch as it is consigned to writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, while sacred tradition takes the word of God entrusted by Christ the Lord and the Holy Spirit to the apostles and hands it on to their successors in all its purity. So that led by the light of the Spirit of truth, they may, in proclaiming it, preserve the Word of God faithfully, explain it, and make it more widely known. Consequently, now listen to this. Consequently, it is not from sacred scripture alone that the church draws her certainty about everything which has been revealed. All right, I'm going to say that again, just to make sure it sinks in. You know, they say that you have to hear something 16 times before the human mind grasps it once and for all. I promise I won't do it 16 times, but I'll do it once more. Consequently, it is not from sacred scripture alone that the church draws her certainty about everything that has been revealed. Now, have you ever gotten into a, for lack of a harsher word, discussion with some of the brethren concerning something, and they say, well, show it to me in the Bible. Let me count the ways and the times. Show it to me in the Bible. It may be in the Bible. A lot of times it is in the Bible. Things like purgatory, oh, it's right in there. You know, if you got eyes to see, it's in there. The Eucharist, the institution of the Eucharist. Is that biblical? You bet. Right in there. Gospel of John, chapter 6, how about, for a good start. There are other places, too. However, there are also things which don't leap out from the page of sacred scripture that are doctrinal things, absolute doctrinal certainties. Well, the church doesn't draw all her certainty from Scripture alone. Remember how it came down to us. Jesus preached. That's the oral transmission. He imparted himself. I like to use that word. It's a better word than teach. Teach is a good word. But you know, the faith is more imparted than taught. Teaching has the normal connotation of you learn something and you hand it on, you know, like a school teacher might do. That's a good thing. That's a very noble thing. Imparting the faith is something that is deeper. It involves an intimacy. The first time I met Mother Teresa of Calcutta, I came in contact with Jesus in a very beautiful and intimate way. She imparted, she radiated Christ to me. A great man from the British media, Malcolm Muggeridge, had studied the faith for many years. He was a very brilliant man. He knew all the arguments, but he couldn't come to conversion and enter the Catholic Church. He met Mother Teresa one day, and boom, that was it. He entered the church. That's imparting the faith. Okay? So the teaching it is one thing. That involves a kind of an extra thing, something extrinsic to yourself. But, you know, I'll probably never teach a course in the seminary because I'm not a seminary professor. But every once in a while they ask me, I'll preach at a seminary or give a retreat. And the men always ask me about preaching. How can I be a good preacher? You know, they think there's a system to it or method. And I say, I'll tell you what the method is. Love Jesus. Come into great intimacy. And then how could you not speak with fire about the one you love? That's it. I mean, right there is to become one with the one who you preach. Become one with the Word of God, and you will radiate the Word of God to your family, to your workplace, to everybody. All right. So we've got tradition, scripture, magisterial teaching, no one of which can subsist without the other two. Now, I'm going to remind you of a passage from the Gospel of Matthew. It's very important. Jesus and his disciples were passing through the region of Caesarea Philippi. Jesus stopped them. And he said, "Who do the people say the Son of Man is?" The first Gallup poll. What's the general population have to say about it? You know, who do the people say I am? Well, some said John the Baptist. Some said Elijah. Some said Jeremiah. Some said one of the other prophets. No, when you take a public opinion poll, what do you get? Well, you get personal opinions. Mere personal opinions. Conflicting and contradictory personal opinions. And they can't all be right. So that's what Jesus got. And then he turned to his closest collaborators. He said, but who do you say that I am? Talking to the apostles. Who do you say that I am? I can well imagine an eerie silence for a moment. Then one voice rang out with all the authenticity and authority of truth. Thou art the Christ, Son of the living God. Ah, Simon, son of John. No mere man has revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I, for my part, stop right there. Who's the I? I, for my part, this is a divine I speaking. This is a divine subject of action speaking. I'm going to give you a little example of how failure in method can lead to less than the desired result. There have been scholars in recent times who have arrived at the conclusion that Jesus never intended to found a church. Oh, yeah. Not only that, I'll tell you a real one. Here's a personal story from I had great teachers all through the seminary, university. I was very fortunate. But every once in a while, even in good places, some bozo sneaks through. And this guy, one day, we knew where he was coming from, but God help us, and he had a degree from, of all places, Berkeley. Need I say more? And the degree was, he went through in the 70s. We already had a cue about where he was coming from, but one day he says, he comes in the classroom, he says, well, today I'm going to tell you about the manna in the desert. And we all kind of looked at each other and we said, this will be good. As the result of advanced scripture scholarship and the findings of archaeology, fasten your seatbelt, we have now been able to conclude what it was that the manna in the desert was. We now know, as the result of scholarship, that the manna in the desert was ant dung. I swear that's what he said. Ant dung! We all looked at each other. And I was coming out of my seat like an MX missile. Because I wanted to ask this biblical scholar what that did for the biblical type of the Eucharist. Now, I know who the scholar was who came to that conclusion, and his name is Satan. That's right. Now, there was a failure in method that led to that conclusion. Oh, many of these scholars just completely ignore the principles the church herself has laid down for engaging in this method. There's a specific method for proceeding in Catholic theology and how Catholics read the Bible. Now, Jesus, a divine person, declares, I declare, how much clearer can it be? I declare. Now, the subject of action is divine. Jesus is the second person of the Blessed Trinity. He's declaring. God's declaring. You are rock, and upon this rock I shall build my church. He changes Simon's name to rock, Peter. Now, there are a lot of explanations of this, and some of the commentaries talk about a big rock and a little rock. Well, listen. The only rock is Jesus Christ. Jesus is the rock. He is the chief cornerstone upon which the church is built, upon which our faith is built. Jesus is the rock, to be sure. But Jesus himself does something mysterious here. He declares Simon to be rock. Now, a name in antiquity meant much more than it does today. A name in antiquity made present, it was, as they say in philosophy, a positive hypostasis that made present the power behind it. A perfect example of it is the name Jesus. God saves. The name and the reality of the being attached to the name are one. God saves. That's Jesus. Peter, rock. What happened? Now, Jesus is the rock. Jesus knew scripture. He was a rabbi. You take a concordance of the Bible, you look through it on the word rock, and you see it many, many times. Most of the time, it's used in the ordinary sense of the term. The rocks rolled down the hillside. They picked up rocks to stone the man. Every once in a while, however, it is capitalized. You are the rock of my salvation. Capital R. He is the rock upon which our faith is built. Capital R. Refers to God. Now, what is Jesus doing? Changing Simon's name to capital R. Simon is not God. We know that. Far from it. He is a weak, sinful man. But Jesus is saying, Simon, I will graft you into myself. A mystical marriage will take place. The two shall become one. And when you speak in my name, it will be me speaking through you in faith and moral. Whoever hears you, hears me. Whoever rejects you, rejects me and him who sent me. the union of Christ, the head of his church, and his mystical body. Peter is the visible head of the church, but the head of the church is Christ. It is Peter, the principle of unity, that we must look to for this teaching. The Pope and the bishops united to him. Now, I'm going to close this hour with a very powerful and very important passage, and it will illustrate to you why good translation is very, very important. Do you remember when Jesus said, "Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brethren." Now, I read that. You've all heard it before, many times. I'm going to read it to you again as it is, and we'll see how many of you have really read it before. "Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you, that he might sift you." You is used twice there, right? Satan has demanded to have you, that he might sift you. The original Greek, the Koine Greek, which is translated properly into Latin, is vos, plural. Satan has demanded to sift, or to have you all. This is the translation. Satan has demanded to have you all, plural, that he might sift you all, plural. "But I have prayed for thee," te in Latin, singular. Satan has demanded to sift all of you as wheat. "But I have prayed for you personally, Peter, and you better be included in the prayer for Peter. For it is in Peter that unity subsists." Now, what happens when you're separated from Peter? Satan sifts us as wheat. And so Martin Luther leaves, and Calvin leaves, and Zwingli leaves, and now we have over 60,000. Christian groups teaching this, that, or the other thing, and I respect them all, but God wills one flock and one shepherd. That is the translation. Satan has demanded you, all of you, that he might sift all of you as wheat, but I have prayed for you, Peter, you personally, and anyone in you will be preserved in unity. How Catholics read the Bible. See you tomorrow.